Okay, so we are in week four of our series entitled Reality Check. And Father Mike, in the last few weeks, has been talking to us about getting a reality check, looking at life from God's perspective and not getting trapped in or dependent on our echo chambers. So that's been where we've been going the last few weeks. This week, Father Mike asked me to talk about the synod that Pope Francis initiated and will be going on for more than a year. So why me talk about the synod? Well, the organization I work with, the Leadership Roundtable, is actually collaborating with the Vatican and the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops to promulgate the synod in the United States. So today, to be honest with you, this is not strictly what I would call a homily. This is more just a discussion about what is the synod. But it does fit into our preaching series nicely, I think, because what we could call a synod is a reality check for the Universal Catholic Church. But a little bit about what is a synod. And it's really very simple. A synod in the Catholic Church is an assembly of bishops who advise the Holy Father on the needs of the church. And usually they call a synod on a specific issue, like on the family or the environment or on youth. But for a couple weeks, bishops assemble in Rome and they talk about the issue and then give advice to the Pope. And it's a very controlled process in the Catholic Church. I mean, even the bishops are told what they are and what they are not allowed to talk about in those synods historically. So there's nothing new about synods. In fact, they started in the early church. But what is radically new about the current synod is that rather than hearing exclusively from bishops, Pope Francis wants to hear from you. So it's just think about it. This is the largest attempt at consultation in human history. But here's how you can be a part. St. Pius will be holding an online listening session via Zoom Tuesday, the 1st of February at 7 p.m. And for those who can't join in online, there will also be a survey on the parish website that you can take. And also in the small groups that meet in the coming weeks, there'll be individual listening sessions as well. But please listen carefully to Katie's endnote at the end of Mass, because she has more of the nitty-gritty details about how to get involved. But saying a little bit more about what the synod is, let me explain to you an experience I had about 15 years ago when I was in Nicosia in Cyprus. I was on a hiking holiday. I hiked around the island of Cyprus. And on Sunday, of course, I went to church. And on the island of Cyprus, almost all of the churches are Greek Orthodox churches. So I went to the Greek Orthodox church closest to my hotel. And this is what I found. I don't know if you can see it very well, but I'll explain it to you. So many of the churches have a courtyard. It's part of the architecture. And these are the gates to the courtyard of the church. And you can hardly see him, but the man in the yellow, like traffic safety vest, he's handing people slips of paper as they come through the gate. And then I also noticed inside the gate in the courtyard, there were tables with metal boxes and people were filling out the slips of paper and then going into church. And of course, I was curious as to what they were doing. Do you have any idea what they were doing? Well, when I asked, I was shocked at the response I got. People were voting for the new archbishop. And this apparently was what they do in the Greek Orthodox Church. Now, can you guess what this is? If you have a campaign, then you typically have campaign posters. I saw these around the island, and I didn't realize what they were until I went to church on Sunday. And I'll tell you, there were about three or four people running for the office of Archbishop. And the funny thing was, to me, all of the posters looked exactly the same. They all looked like guys in that outfit with white beards. But I guess the locals knew the difference among the three or four different campaign posters. So why am I telling you this? Because this was a mind-blowing experience for me, because, you know, in the governance of the Roman Church, you and I are not very invited into that process. In the Roman Church, the selection of bishops, archbishops, and popes is an incredibly secretive process. In fact, if you are involved in the process of the selection of a bishop, for example, you have to swear an oath of secrecy that you will never discuss it with anybody. So look at the difference between the Roman Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church, where a bishop actually has to tell people what he's going to do if he gets the job. So I came to learn that, you know, the process of discernment could be different. You know, it was a reality check for me. It was a mind-blowing experience that, wow, things could be very different. And our tradition of discernment on the administration of the church, you know, has, in the Roman Rite, has exclusively been hierarchical and as I said, secretive. Now, what's the history behind this posture in the Roman Church? Well, part of it can be explained by the fact that, you know, up until 100 years ago or so, the vast majority of Catholics would have been illiterate, right? It was only a small percentage of the population that would have been educated and could read and write. So the typical way clergy communicated with members of the church was through teaching and exhortation and enforcing rules. But times have changed. Now, I know most of you are a heck of a lot smarter than I am, right? So we need a different form of communication. It just can't be this one way. You know, we, the enlightened clergy, tell you what to do, right? We need a different process, and that's exactly what the Pope is trying to inculcate or enculturate in the Roman Church right now. Now, will we ever get to the point where there's campaign posters for the Archbishop of Washington? Probably not in any of our lifetimes. However, what the Pope does want is a more inclusive process. So this example of Cyprus, I think speaks, as I said, even though we're not going to start voting, although you never know, who knows? Things are changing so quickly, we might be. But short of voting for the next archbishop, Pope Francis wants us to, you know, change the way that popes get advice. That he's not just in an echo chamber listening to bishops. He wants to create a culture in which Catholics discern where the Holy Spirit is leading the church. Because Pope Francis believes that the Holy Spirit is speaking through the members of the church, the ordinary people, just as much as the Holy Spirit speaks through bishops. Now, your reaction might be, well, it's about time, right? But there are a lot of people who are just, and I'm not talking about just bishops and priests, there are a lot of lay people who are not particularly happy with the way the Pope is moving the church. They would say something like, this is crazy. Bishops should be making the decisions, right? So if you follow Vatican politics, You might know that Pope Francis has been trying very hard since he was elected. He's been trying very hard to reform the administration of the Vatican from a culture of really clerical tyranny to humble service. He himself is modeling that. He was spotted 2 weeks ago driving his own car to he wanted to buy an old-fashioned LP, you know, a vinyl record, and he would go online, he couldn't find it. There's the Pope driving his own car, little Fiat, I think he has, and he's in there buying his record at the record shop. Not typically what you would see a Pope doing historically. He lives in an apartment. He refuses to live in the Pope's palace. But you can imagine how this is stirring things up in the Vatican, right? Many Vatican cardinals are getting their own reality check. You know, they've been accustomed to living life large as, you know, princes of the church, you know, living very lavishly. And he's now saying, no, that's not what we're called to. We're called to be humble servants. You can imagine how some of them are reacting to that. But in his attempt to change the Vatican culture, Pope Francis has faced a tremendous opposition, you know, from insiders, and not just inside the Vatican, others as well. But there's nothing new about that. Anytime you want to make change, you're going to get opposition. Those, you know, just think about it. If the status quo is working for you, why would you want to change it? And then when somebody comes along and wants to change the status quo, watch out. You could get killed. But let's look at the gospel, because there's nothing new about this, like, opposition to provocative thought. You know, in the gospel we just heard, when the people in the synagogue heard this, they were all filled with fury. They rose up, drove him, Jesus, out of the town and led him to the brow of the hill on which the town had been built to hurl him down headlong, to kill him, right? So we see, even in the gospel, the same opposition to Jesus from synagogue insiders. Now, just some clarification on what the synagogue is. The synagogue is different from the temple where the sacrifices are offered. Synagogue was a place of learning, right? So that's where slam would have taken place, or small groups, or even this preaching that I'm doing now would have taken place in a synagogue. And they're upset because he's just a regular guy. He's not an official of the synagogue. He holds no titles, right, and no distinction, and he's not even particularly well-educated. So who is he to be telling us about life, right? And then he also points out that, you know, the God who loves the Jews so much doesn't just love the Jews. He loves the Gentiles too. And he kind of rubs it in their face that, you know, at times when Israel was on hard times, prophets were sent to the Gentiles, the widow in Zarephath and Sidon, and Elisha was sent to Syria. Those are not Jewish countries, right? So he's reminding them that God is not exclusively theirs. And there's something about that that get them very upset. They had this very exclusive understanding of their relationship with God, and Jesus provoked them to get out of their echo chamber, right? So historically, these, you know, insights tell us that it's easy for people who are in the know or who are official or who have status or credentials or education to begin to think that they're the only ones that have inside, they have access to God or the Holy Spirit. So there's nothing new about that. So what the Pope is trying to do with this synod is say, you know what, the Holy Spirit works through all of us, not just a select few who happen to hold particular titles and status and credentials. Pope Francis wants to know what you think about the church and how the church, you know, is doing in how it listens to people. Now, don't get upset and want to throw me off the, you know, a cliff here for saying this, but the Pope doesn't want to just hear from you. He wants to hear from people who are not here. So please make an effort to invite neighbors, friends, family members who are no longer practicing Catholics, because if we just hear from us who are here, we're not getting all the information. We need to hear from people who are not here. The Pope really wants to hear from people who are not here as well. So invite family members or friends to one of the listening sessions and let them know they are very, very welcome. So, in this preaching series, we're being asked to consider a reality check. You know, a reality check for our own lives. What's our perspective? Are we trying to get a perspective that is aligned with God's perspective? Today, I'm suggesting that you be a reality check for the Catholic Church. If there is a massive response to the Pope's request to hear from you, then it will send a clear message that the Holy Spirit is working through all of us. And regardless of any specific outcomes, I want to manage your expectations here. It's not as if there's going to be radical change to processes and procedures and the way the church does things overnight, right? However, the mere participation in the listening sessions is incredibly important. Widespread participation in the listening sessions will start a movement that can't be stopped. That can't be stopped by people who are uncomfortable with what regular people have to say about the church. Most of us would agree that the church could use a reality check. Through your participation in the listening sessions, you are the reality check. And by inviting as many people as possible to participate, we are the reality check. And as I said, even though we might not see drastic change overnight, what we can do through our participation is send a clear signal that we care about the church and we are not about to give up. Now that's a reality check.